Over the years, including Willa Cather. Now, if you're curious about what Willa Cather liked to read, please come, because we'll be having a wonderful exhibition about her and her relationship to the library. And it's such a pleasure to welcome Daphne Merkin tonight, who will be speaking about her brilliant and harrowing memoir, This Close to Happy, A Reckoning with Depression. Having suffered with depression myself, her vivid descriptions were sometimes hard for me to read. However, I could not put it down. She writes with wit and insight about her amazing life. Daphne is a literary critic, essayist, novelist, teacher, and now author of this stunning memoir. She worked as an editor for Harpo Grace Jovanovich, and she was a staff writer for The New Yorker. She has written a novel and two collections of essays. Her essays, entitled The Famed Lunches, were one of the New York Times Review's 100 notable books of the year. And I learned very recently that in addition to all this, she is a wonderful pianist. I will close this with a quote from Gloria Vanderbilt. If the face presented to the world is a mask to protect ourselves, Daphne Merkin bravely removes hers, revealing the truth of herself, courageously exploring, seeking, sometimes finding the hope that glimmers on and off so briefly at the end of the tunnel. Please read as soon as possible. Hope awaits. Mm-hmm. And now let us welcome Daphne Merkin.
Very glad to be here. I don't know, like some of you, I've always thought of this library as my secret. A lot of people think of this library as their secret. And I once, when I first joined, I worked in one of the little rooms up all the way up the top. I think at that time I was working on a novel, so it was ages ago. Oh, is this better? Yeah. I've been thinking I was going to read a little from the book, talk a little, and then take questions and answers. I've been doing a little book touring. I went to the West Coast. And I've been thinking a lot about why depression, of all illnesses, conditions, whatever you want to call it, remains both sort of elusive, as I say someplace in the book, over-medicalized, under-diagnosed, every contradiction you can think of. And I was thinking, I wrote today a few things down that I've been thinking about in the week since my book came out at the beginning of February. And that's essentially that, I think one of the reasons the subject of depression is difficult to capture, to convey to other people, is that I've decided we all think in these very neo-Cartesian terms, in like convenient dualisms. So we have nature, nurture, mind, body, and all sorts of other neat black and white categories, when the truth is that most phenomena partake of some mixture of the two. This is especially true, I think, of a condition like depression, which doesn't fit easily into any category, but seems rather to entail a combination of a mood disorder, a melancholic inclination like the constitutional unhappiness, if that's in quotes, and morbid melancholy, also in quotes, that James Boswell was always noticing in Samuel Johnson, or the despair that flits in and out of Emily Dickinson's poems. It constitutes that, as well as a bona fide biochemical disease. And I was thinking a lot that as far as the nature-nurture argument goes about psychiatric illness, the pendulum keeps swinging from one to the other, depending what the fashion is, when again, the reality is that most psychiatric illnesses are a combination. At some point, nurture segues into nature. You have enough experience of an unharmonious or unhappy sort, it will eventually affect your brain. So I was thinking about during the 1950s and 60s, there was a consuming belief in the environmental factors shaping personality, and this approach led to handy but reductive terms like the schizophrenogenic mother and Bruno Bettelheim's misguided theory that withholding mothers caused autism. On the other hand, I think close to our own time, we live under the tyranny of the biological, fearing that, that the imprint of our chemically ordained personalities. And I think the emergence of Prozac in the 70s, was it, or 80s, I think gave, right, I was actually, I should know this since I was put on an experimental dose, drastic effects. With Prozac, I think the biological notion of depression gained traction. Of course, neither approach, nature-nurture, makes sense without the other, because depression, and this is something I have written about, isn't in any simple sense inheritable, which I think is one of the things people worry about. There is, by that I mean, there is no single genetic marker for it, like there is for some diseases such as Tay-Sachs, cystic fibrosis, and sickle cell anemia. They all have single markers. And as much as we understand about it, it's likely that multiple genes contribute simultaneously to the chances of its being transmitted. Scientists have adduced from the ubiquitous twin studies that they're always adducing things from, that the heritability of depression is about 40%. And although this sounds fairly high, it isn't when you consider that heritability refers only to an underlying risk of depression, not to depression itself. And I remember when I was writing about this issue, a doctor pointed out to me that people find genes handy, to use the genetic argument, is a handy receptacle for blame in what he calls a high-stakes responsibility game. We want to know, in other words, if it's our fault or not our fault, or perhaps our mother's fault. And if it's your genes, no one is culpable. And what a relief that is, if that were the fact case. When I was writing this book, over the many years it took me to write it, 15 to be exact, because it started out as an article in New Yorker called The Black Season in 2001. And then I, for a variety of reasons, including suffering from depression, severe depression, but other reasons, the difficulty of the subject, that I always kind of look for pieces to write against this overwhelming theme. I also had three publishing houses, three book contracts. But I remember talking to, I know who it was, because I profiled her, it was Diane Keaton, the actress, and she said to me, everyone's a little depressed. Hmm. And I remember thinking, no one would say, everyone's a little schizophrenic, which is in itself an interesting distinction, that in part for most people it's both in a way threatening. I think it's like fear of contagion. I was thinking of the stigma that depression continues to have, which I think it does continue to have. And I think also our culture has something to do with it, which is that we've sort of elasticized depression so that everyone who has a bad moment or an off day says, I'm depressed. Yeah. And we underrate its seriousness when it appears in clinical form and still resort to pull yourself up by your bootstraps kind of thinking, counsel, which I think contributes to one of the things that I think make depression difficult is that it's by its nature isolating. I don't think people kind of readily engage other people about it. Even usually, I did a talk with Dick Cavett at the 92nd Street Y some weeks ago, and he said that he became, because I think he went public, or relatively public, with the fact that he had had electroshock treatment, so that he became, as he called him, the poster boy. But I was thinking, in the world in which I think a lot of us live, it's kept private in a way that people will discuss other things. But I'm going to read a little bit at this point. This is from the very beginning of the book. A woman is standing in her kitchen, making a pot of coffee, spooning out the pungent, overpriced ground beans from their snappy little aluminum bag into a paper filter, trying to remember what number tablespoon she was on, 4, 6, 3, before the dark thoughts began tumbling in, doing their wild and wily gymnastics. You shouldn't. You should've. Why are you? Why aren't you? There's no hope. It's too late. It's always been too late. Give up. Go back to bed. There's no hope. The day is half gone. No, the day ahead is too long. There's so much to do. There's not enough to do. Everything is futile. There is no hope. What, she wonders for the zillionth time, would it be like to be someone with a brighter take on things, with a more sustainable sense of the purposefulness of his or her existence? Someone possessed of the necessary illusions that things make sense and will work out for the better, especially if you cultivate your own garden, without which life is unbearable. Surely that person would be sticking with the coffee, not leapfrogging to suicidal desires at the first promptings of despair. What that is, would it be like to be someone showered and dressed and more or less ready to face the day, not jumping for joy, but not hobbled by gloom either? For surely this is the worst part of being someone who is at the mercy of her own mind the way she is, pickled in the brine of self-hatred. The fact that there is no way out of the reality of being her, no relief in sight other than through forceful or at least conscientious intervention, talk therapy, medication, attempts at forward march thinking, remembering the starving and the maimed and the generally less fortunate, until she's up and standing and has hauled herself forward to that point of preparedness other people seem to arrive at with a naturalness of purpose that is utterly foreign to her. Then I go on to explain that I kind of, a little bit about, that I call it the dark season, depression, as a way of aestheticizing it a little bit or keeping it removed. And then I talk about that depression comes, you know, that you can't predict when depression comes. It actually comes when it feels like it. So the plunging mood can be sudden and steep, taking her unawares. One minute she's feeling more or less okay, the next like shooting her head off. It can occur on a Monday afternoon, for instance, when she's returned home from a dentist appointment, to an empty apartment, and the very motes in the air strike her as desolate. She feels isolated, stuck in a cave of grief, of ancient and permanent sorrow. And then right on the wings of this feeling, gurgling up from somewhere inside her, comes the impulse to kill herself. It's so strong that she goes over to the wood block of knives that sits on the kitchen counter and takes one out, running its serrated edge across her thumb. She envisions herself slashing her wrists. No, filling a bathtub with water first, and then slashing her wrists. Isn't that the way to ensure death, the way Deanna Arbus did it? To stop herself from thinking about it any further, she gets into her bed and lies there waiting for the impulse to pass. Depression is a global problem affecting 350 million people worldwide. It might be, have gone up since I wrote that number. In the United States, 16 million people had at least one major depressive episode in 2012. And in 2014, there were more than 40,000 deaths by suicide. And yet this is a sadness that no one seems to want to talk about in public, not even in this age of indiscretion. At cocktail parties, for instance, you can talk endlessly about attending AA meetings or your stint in rehab without raising any eyebrows. But just imagine trying to tell the truth about how you feel at an upscale social gathering where everyone's milling around, wine glass in hand, keeping a narrowed eye out for the next person, the person who isn't you. How are you? Not fine, but very depressed, in fact. Can barely get out of bed. Have no idea what's happening in the world lately, and don't much care. Who wants to hear it? Has ever wanted to hear it? Will ever want to hear it? In spite of our anything goes tell-all culture, so much of the social realm is closed against too much real personal disclosure. That's actually something I've been thinking about giving a talk called The Anxiety of Disclosure, what comes behind all this. Too much ruffling of the surface. We live in a society that is embarrassed by interiority unless it is presented in a shrill, almost campy style under the aegis of the recovery movement with its insistence on dramatic personal testimony. Rigorous self-reflection, a sober and nuanced wrestling with personal demons, has gone out with the great vexed Victorians, like John Ruskin, Thomas Carlyle, and Matthew Arnold. Nor is the private realm particularly conducive to airing this sort of implacable feeling, no matter how affectionate or willing to listen friends are. Depression, in its insistence on its own stubborn one-note reality, becomes boring for other people to hear about, patient as they may initially be. Take a yoga class, they advise, or get a massage. Just don't go on and on about it, is what they don't say, but you can see the resistance to joining you in your gloom in the set of their jaw. It's about what I saw as a fashionably gendered divide on how depression narratives are told, which is a difference between men and women. So I go on and I say the woman that I'm talking about is me, of course, but she might be anyone suffering from an affliction that haunts women almost twice as much as men, even though it is curiously mostly men who write about it. They are also four times more likely to kill themselves than women are, though they are diagnosed as depressed and populate psychiatric units in far smaller numbers than women. It's always interested me that notwithstanding the far greater statistical occurrence of depression in women, men seem to cast larger shadows than women even here, as though their illness were evidence of a cultural rather than personal distress. In the male version of the depression narrative, as I found it, the blackness of mood arrives mostly like a pox, without warning. There are exceptions to this model, such as the accounts by Andrew Solomon and Edward St. Aubin in his novels, but usually there's no indication of gloomy temperamental leanings. Instead, the finger is pointed at a specific precipitating cause outside the self, such as the after effects of a significant death, which in truth is a reactive depression, also known as grief, which doesn't really qualify as clinical depression, or withdrawn from alcohol or a sleeping pill, or again, if being diagnosed with a serious illness. One minute you are puttering about being a highly successful writer or scientist. The next you are seriously contemplating jumping off the Brooklyn Bridge. Or conversely, there is no external cause at all. Like Chicken Little, you wake up one morning to discover the sky is falling. Men, that is, have cannily figured out how to sidestep the implication of moral failing that attaches to mental illness, as well as the specific criticism of self-indulgence that is attributed to more introspective accounts of this condition by insisting on a force outside themselves or on a purely genetic susceptibility. The female version of this narrative, by contrast, tends to tip the other way, as epitomized by Anne Sexton's poetry and Sylvia Plath's The Bell Jar. Female sufferers tend to take ownership of the condition of depression, accepting that it springs not only from errant biology, but from a yawning inner lack, some elusive craving for wholeness or well-being. This writing is usually highly interior, almost to a fault. The world in which the narrator moves when she is not depressed is given such short shrift that it tends to fall away entirely. And then I talk about the many, many terms depression has been given in history, which include acedia, melancholia, malaise, kafar, brown study, that was the Victorian usage, the hypes, the blues, the mean reds, the black dog, the blue devils, the dismals, lap sickness. And then there was a term I found used by Hutterites, which is amphetamine. And then it's been treated variously as a spiritual malady, a failure of will, a biochemical malfunctioning, a psychic conundrum, or sometimes several things at once. And then I'm going to just read, because I explain why, I talk about why I think the stigma surrounding depression remains real, which I think has something to do with shame and something self-implicating about depression that even other psychiatric illnesses don't quite have. At least it doesn't seem to me. And then I add, it does not, for example, fit neatly in with the literature of addiction and recovery, and it offers the reader no vicarious thrills, mostly because its symptoms are rarely florid enough to alienate or even titillate people. If there is something intangible about mental illness generally, depression is all the harder to define because it tends to creep in rather than announce itself, manifesting itself as an absence of appetite, energy, sociability, rather than as a presence. There is little you can point to, no obscene rantings, no sudden flips into unrecognizable hyper-energized behavior, no magical belief systems involving lottery numbers or fortune cookies. It seems to me that we are suspicious of depression's claim to legitimacy in part because it doesn't look crazy. And then I'm just going to read why it's taken me so long, or felt like forever. I just taught a master class, as it was called at Hunter, about on the memoir, and the first thing I wrote on the board when I came in, or whatever that white black board is now, was courage. Because I think in the end, although it often looks, I think there are always problems with the memoir form, specifically more by women. I don't think men so much get accusations of self-indulgence as much as women do. But I think in some way the memoir form looks like a display of self. There's no way around it. So that in some ways, and I think it's actually a very, you know, if it's well done, it's a less than an unpacking of things that requires a lot of scrutiny. I mean, especially if you're writing a psychological kind of memoir. And I guess I go back to this term courage, because you have to some way, I think in some way, set yourself apart from what you're writing about. Otherwise you could go through life thinking everyone knows everything about you, and of course, no one knows what you left out. And all memoirs leave things out. Even me. I first agreed to write this book 15 years ago, in the wake of publishing a piece in the New Yorker about being hospitalized for depression. I'll just pause and say that I remember after writing that piece, and I had written other personal, some might call them confessional, pieces about my family and my erotic tastes and such things. I remember this felt to me utterly naked to write about depression in a way that these other pieces didn't. I believe it has taken me this long to actually get it done, because in writing about depression, I am doing battle with both my ongoing fear of depression's return and my actual recurring bouts of it. But I am also doing battle with childhood ghosts, with the inhibitions I carry about the value of my story and whether I'm allowed to tell it. The slaying of ghosts is never easy, and my ghosts are particularly authoritative, exhorting me to keep my head down and my saga to myself. Finally, though, I am writing this book in an effort to exert some mastery over my own experience by closely observing it. One of the quotes, I just have two quotes in the beginning. One is from the diary of Virginia Woolf, and this kind of kept me going, which is observe perpetually, observe my own despondency. By that means it becomes serviceable, or so I hope. My hope is that I will improve my chances of survival. I think I meant literal survival. If I am clear about what is at stake, my life as I have slowly begun to make it, not as it has been made by others. In the process, I am trying not only to shatter the sinister enchantment of my childhood, but also to wrest my story away from my own earlier telling of it, a narrative that once may have felt necessary and true, but that has by now become its own sort of prison. I think one issue I had in writing this book was, how do you write a book about severe, recurrent, hospitalizable depression that isn't a total depressive piece of writing? I mean, I'm sure there are people who, I've been told, just, you know, a friend of mine charmingly told me that a few friends of hers didn't want to read the book because they thought it'd be too depressing. And I have no doubt that for some people it is too, you know, it is. But my hope was that I would make depression sort of a vivid character, and that I'd go back and forth. I mean, I went through so many drafts of this book and decided to put a little more of my life in it, because I was sort of, on some level, I was, I went through different permutations. I've noticed instead of the word permutation or version, everyone uses the word iteration nowadays. So I'm going back to permutation. So I went back and forth, like, what would illuminate it? And how personal is too personal? When do you sort of, I'm going to read one other section. Another issue I just add in a book about a subject such as depression is how do you end it? If you don't want to write, which I did not, was not writing a self-help book. I mean, not in a overt way. If someone is helped by the book, I'd be thrilled and hope they are. But I wasn't going to end and say, take 3 aspirin and call me in the morning. But I think in the process of writing it, a certain arc became clearer to me in my own life, which is well, I once said to someone, I thought you age out of depression, which and until you get old age depression, a brief period of light. But I think in my case, I gave up the idea of a cure, because I think for a lot of things there aren't cures, but I think if you have a tendency to clinical depression, or what I was told when I got terribly depressed and didn't eat and didn't move and didn't speak, that I was in the hideous term used for it was that I was in a vegetative state. I think if you have any tendency to get that dark, you can't just sort of shove the tendency out. But what I think I sort of learned to do, or hope I've learned to do, is sort of navigate my own, like use a little cunning around my own dips. Also, this sounds probably hackneyed, but I think one thing I say at the end of the book, which I wish I would have emphasized, is that I think I've just found the line, which is something that I think of myself. I don't know if it's true of other people who suffer from depression. I wrote, if I can't quite declare victory over my depression, I'm giving it a run for its money, navigating around it, reminding myself that the opposite of depression is not a state of unimaginable happiness, but a state of approximate contentment, of relative all rightness. Perhaps depressives expect too much of life when they're not feeling depressed, have too exalted an idea of what the standard is. And this is something that I wrote from self-knowledge. I'm just going to read from one other part. The simplest test for gauging depression that I know of, infinitely more efficient than answering a long list of questions about how much you've been sleeping, or how little you've been eating, or how often thoughts of suicide flashed across your mind, is the arrival of the first beautiful day of the year. The sort of day Dorothy Parker balefully serenaded. Every year, back spring comes with the nasty little birds yapping their fool heads off. The sort of emblematic day they're always composing song lyrics about, when the normally indifferent world nudges you like a persistent shoe salesman and says, try me, I've got a couple of tricks up my sleeve that will make you smile. The kind of day that hints at green shoots and splashes of yellow light, nothing autumnal or wintry in sight. It might arrive right on schedule at the start of spring, or it might arrive radically out of season, but the symptoms are always the same. The sun is out, skies are clear, the air is charged with the possibility of happiness, and everyone suddenly seems to be holding hands with someone else. It takes a day like that to make me realize that the way I feel, which is like sticking ever closer to the walls of my home, clutching at my skin for cover, avoiding unnecessary distraction from the deadly beat of my own deadly thoughts, is not a natural or even an inevitable condition. One of the most intolerable aspects of depression is the way it insinuates itself everywhere in your life, casting a pall not only over the present, but over the past and the future as well, suggesting nothing but its own inevitability. I know one thing I've always found hard to is the notion that it would pass, which in fact, even without medication or an ounce of therapy or ECT, which I myself resisted having, but I certainly think helps the people who it helps. When people would say to me, it will pass, I felt almost outraged. I mean, you don't feel it will pass. For the fact is that the quiet terror of severe depression never entirely passes once you've experienced it. It hovers behind the scenes, placated temporarily by medication and a willed effort at functioning, waiting to slither back in. It sits in the space behind your eyes, making its presence felt even in those moments when other, lighter matters are at the forefront of your mind. It tugs at your awareness, keeping you from ever being fully at ease in the present. When I'm depressed, it's hard, almost impossible, to keep track of the reality that even the most extreme depression will pass with time or can be made to pass more quickly with the help of medication or therapy or some combination of both. It is not, for instance, the blight man was born for, which happens to be death and is in point of fact unavoidable, even for those lucky people who've never had a suicidal moment. The phrase, the blight man was born for, is from the poem Spring and Fall, which was written by one of my favorite poets, the self-loathing 19th century Jesuit priest, Gerard Manley Hopkins. I imagine Hopkins as having been fat and white and sweaty, reeking of despair. In the sonnet, My Own Heart, he wrote, my own heart let me more have pity on. Let me live to my sad self hereafter kind, charitable. He may in fact have been thin and pristine, but what I do know to be true is that he had an ongoing lover's quarrel with God and that he died in his rooms at the top of a building that was once part of University College in James Joyce's Dublin and now houses a sleek restaurant. It is probably all but impossible, this was a little of my literary critic coming in, from a contemporary perspective, to avoid at least nibbling at the speculation that Hopkins' anguish bids for signs of divine attention. His, quote, cries like dead letters sent to dearest him that lives, alas, away, was a sublimation of his homoerotic urges. But what I find more interesting and far more moving is the poet's pre-Freudian approach to his own undeniably depressive nature, which leads him to interpose his religious calling between himself and his conviction of hopelessness. It is his lack of faith he blames for his condition, rather than his genes or his childhood. I envy Hopkins his faith, complexly negotiated as it was, and I've often wished my own Jewish upbringing had provided more of a religious anchor. I imagine a belief in God must come with a dazzling sense of purpose. Somewhere along the way, however, I substituted a more tentative and secular faith in the power of art to uphold and console. I think I share with Hopkins not only a delight in words, but an underlying conviction that language can transmute personal pain into a shared grief about what living in the world entails. There's going to be one more, but I'll the final where it ends, but I could take a question.
Why, yes, this is great.
This is as close as I get to a happy ending. The last chapter is set in a rented summer house. And I begin with grumbling, as I often do, that I'm getting older. While all this is going on now, I need reading glasses, although I forgot them tonight. So much do I resist them. And my arthritic knees, I write, you see, I've grown older, despite the fact that I've dreamed of killing myself since I was a young girl, leaning out the seventh floor bedroom window and imagining myself jumping soundlessly to the street, away from everything that was wrong with my family and away from my incessant tears. There was a line in Jean Rhys's unfinished, posthumously published autobiography, Smile Please, that states the dilemma exactly. Oh God, I'm only 20, and I'll have to go on living and living and living. So I'm at this summer house. Waiting for my daughter to come out, and I have two friends out with me. I have not been back in the hospital for 8 years, although I've had some very shaky times when all the negative feelings pop up again, robust as can be. I once dreamed of conquering my depression for good, but I've come to understand that it is a chronic condition, as much a part of me as my literary bent. To this day, I can't figure out if it qualifies as a full-fledged disease. Although there's a part of me that would, someone said to me, didn't you read your own book? I can't figure out if it qualifies as a full-fledged disease like cancer, but I've learned the hard way to give it, ephemeral as it may seem, its due. So although I fantasize about going off medication for good, I continue to pop my pills prophylactically, the side effects notwithstanding. And I continue to see a shrink, a combined approach that works as well as can be hoped for. And then I say, one night last winter, I heard my daughter's name is Zoe. I heard myself repeating to Zoe, much to my surprise, something my friend E has told me over and over again. Life is a gift, I told my daughter. And then to underline the point, I added, a great gift. I expected Zoe to roll her eyes, especially at this kind of semi-pious sentiment coming from me, but instead she looked intrigued. When I first heard my friend say this, it went over my head, like the maxim I spotted on a list in a store window as I was walking along Madison Avenue. Activate self-esteem. What I wondered could that possibly mean? You either were possessed of self-esteem or you weren't. It wasn't something you simply activated. It in turn reminds me of a statement I saw stitched on a bright Jonathan Adler pillow. Hope is chic, as though hope were the new navy, decorative rather than essential. Although I'm not sure how much I believe that life is a gift, if only because no one asks you whether you in particular desire to be born before you tunnel your way out of the womb, I very much want to believe it. Perhaps it's a sign of growing older, but anything else seems ungrateful, even to me. I close my eyes, I'm in a pool, and float where the water takes me. It is a lambent Saturday afternoon in July, not intolerably hot, with a slight breeze stirring the leaves on the trees. The two friends I have invited for the weekend are reading on deck chairs, and Zoe, who has been expected all day, is predictably late. It is not an exceptional scene, but it is one that I cannot imagine having arranged until relatively recently, one that requires me to take the helm, instead of hoping that someone else will manage things for me. I stand up in the pool with the intention of doing a few laps, when suddenly somewhere in the sky, I could swear I feel my mother's presence, more benign than not. My mother is a large figure in this book, mostly not benign. For a moment, I feel her loss intensely, and when I'm sure no one is watching, I look up and give her a little wave, just in case. After swimming back and forth vigorously a few times, I get out of the water, wrap a towel, talus style, around my shoulders, and sink down on a chair next to my friends. They are discussing whether or not they believe in psychics. Jay, who is very logical, is explaining why she considers them to be con artists, while Elle, an editor for one of the magazines I write for, insists on keeping a more open mind. I pick up the book I've been reading, K.L., an 800-page history of concentration camps, my typical light summer fare, that is both heartbreaking and riveting, when Zoe suddenly appears in the entrance to the garden, dressed in her usual floppy clothes and carrying a bulging backpack. There you are, I say, I was giving up on you. In an hour or so, the four of us will take a walk to the shabby pizzeria come Mexican restaurant I have taken a liking to, frequented mainly by locals rather than summer folk. Later, we will watch TV or play word games while eating tubs of pale ice cream, and Zoe will pick an argument with me before the night is done, as if on cue, something to do with the way I wash dishes or host guests that is intrinsically objectionable. As we are going to bed, she'll remind me to take my evening meds. Then just before I'm about to turn off the light, she'll come into my room, lean over and give me a quick, barely there kiss. After she leaves, I'll lie in the dark and think about the small group of family and friends I've gathered under my borrowed roof, peeping a life I've often found difficult to bear, but that right now at least seems like one worth claiming. I root around in my head for the usual sense of insufficiency, a clamorous lack waiting to be filled, but for the time being anyway, it is nowhere to be found. The room feels cozy and I pull the fluffy comforter closer around me against the pleasant chill of the AC. Tomorrow presents itself as a glimpse of sun and water, hours to reading, shared meals, and wandering conversation. As my eyelids start to droop, I suddenly recall a favorite line of poetry by Charles Olson. I have had to learn the simplest things last, which made for difficulties. Whoever thought I'd be this close to happy? Are there any questions?
You don't mention too much about your early life, about your mother and dad and how they reacted to your condition, you know, as you were growing up.
Oh, you're asking or
I'm sorry, what?
Oh, and I wasn't sure if you were asking me or you're saying that I don't.
That you don't. You haven't, to us, told us much about your early.
Right. Well, much of the book, I mean, a big part of the book focuses on my unnurturing childhood, which I think contributed to some of my unhappiness. So there is a big, in intermittent chapters, I go into the family and the past. I was first hospitalized for, I think it was called precocious depression when I was 8. So I do go into it.
I'm intrigued by the idea that examining anything deeply changes that thing. And I'm wondering how the experience of writing the book changed the way you might experience, if it experienced depression itself.
Did you hear? You were saying that you're intrigued by the idea of the way examining something might change it.
Has writing the book changed the way you experience depression?
I'm not sure. That's as honest an answer as I have.
Do episodes of depression seem correlated with anything that happens in the outside world affecting relationships or anything in your life?
In my case, there might have been a precipitating factor. I mean, I got very, very depressed and was hospitalized within 2 years of my mother's death. My mother, with whom I had a very, very difficult relationship. But I don't know if, I think there usually is something that sets it off, but it's not enough to account for the downward slide. I mean, if you were in another state of mind, it might put you in a week-long bad, you know, sadness, but it wouldn't lead to your immobility. I think that's not so clear how it happens, when it happens.
This is somewhat related. Oh, I'm sorry.
No, you go ahead.
It's somewhat related to that woman's question. When you read the sentences about that you can achieve relative contentedness, was that something that you knew before you started writing the book, or did you arrive at that through the writing of the book?
I think that's a very good question.
Could you repeat that?
Whether, when I say that, you can achieve relative contentedness rather than some incredible counter-depressive state. Did I arrive at that while writing the book, or did I think it before? But I think that is one of the things I came to writing the book. That somehow, in some ways, there's some correlation between, if I think about it, I always thought I didn't have enough illusions, but that I had too many expectations. There's some way to balance that out, that you expect a little less. So I think that came to me writing the book.
When you have a deadline for your books, do you feel elated or depressed? Does the pressure, the pressure of a deadline, how do you react to that?
Well, I was deeply, deeply late on this book by years. I do a lot of literary journalism and that kind of thing. I find it works as an antidepressive to take me out of myself. Whether it's to go to Sweden to write about a mattress, or to write a profile of Tom Stoppard, they're all ways of sort of using my energy outward. But I think a deadline doesn't make me, if I'm not depressed, it doesn't make me depressed. It makes me anxious. But the necessity to meet it in some way.
Exactly.
I have two parts. Number one, clearly you're a gifted writer, and I wonder if you can get in touch with that when you're depressed, or does the depression interfere with your contacting that?
Yes, it does.
Okay. So there are moments maybe when you go back and forth, you know, because you say life is a gift, but you also have a gift. And okay, that's one part. Number two, I had an insight when you were talking, and that is the whole theme of isolation, which is, you know, as a psychiatrist, I hear that all the time. And what we psychiatrists learn in the first year is simply listening is such a gift to give someone.
True.
But paradoxically, people don't know what a gift that is in public situations or social situations.
Mm-hmm.
And if we could teach everybody, you don't have to do anything.
Right.
You simply have to listen.
True. No,
and it's easier, you know, if you feel tremendous relief when you say, I don't have to do anything. I don't have to tell them. I don't have to give advice. I simply have to listen.
Right. No, I think that's very true. At one of the readings I gave, I think it was in San Francisco, someone said to me, precisely said, what should I do for a very depressed friend? And I said, just listen and don't offer up a million solutions.
Well, wouldn't it be wonderful if we could teach everybody that?
Right.
Daphne, I think the book is wonderful and very serviceable. And you touched upon, you know, to quote Wolf as saying, be serviceable. And you're talking about, you know, could you talk a little bit more about how you so wonderfully make your pieces serviceable rather than just self-indulgent or
I think the main reason, without sounding whatever the word is, saccharine about it, that I did, since I dropped the book at various times, had all these other book plans, I think what made me come back to it was I remember after I wrote the piece that was in the New Yorker, I got a lot of letters. And one woman wrote me to say that she wishes her sister had read the piece and had gone into the hospital instead of killing herself. So one thing I wanted to write about was the hospitalization experience, which I think is also stigmatized. I think they're for very good reasons. People don't want to, I mean, I didn't want to go into a hospital even, but I think there are things that it does. So that was one thing I wanted to write about. And I guess I kept a postcard from an artist who said the black dog had killed his father and I hides under his bed. And I sort of thought in my head, I'm writing to these other people who suffer in silence.
Can you just talk a little bit about the process of writing a memoir versus fiction? I mean, was it interesting trying to find an arc out of your life? Kind of, I mean, it's one thing to do an essay, but to do a long book and think of it, okay, here's the rise in action, here's the,
right.
But it's actually life, and just say at all about that?
Well, I would say one thing just about the fiction-nonfiction distinction, quoting Virginia Woolf again, my favorite, she said, if you want to tell the truth, write fiction. Keep in mind. I think with fiction, you also have to invent an arc. I mean, you're writing lives. But it's true that in memoir, I don't know how many people feel their own life's arc. So I think you sort of trick it. I mean, technically, you create an arc. I try to do it by, the book isn't told completely chronologically. I am often in the present, and then I go back, but I go forward from going back, if that makes any sense. So I kept back going. I kept thinking, keep the string pulled. So I think the simple use, I resisted all chronology when I started it. But an editor friend said to me, you know, Daphne, if you don't have some chronology, this will just read. I just read a book recently by a Chinese writer that was reviewed a few weeks ago, something like, I've come here to tell you about my life. Do you know what book I mean? Yeah. And it was a slim book. She just won Paris Review Award. Where's your friend?
Yes. My life. It's Yi Yu Li is the author, yeah.
Yes. Mm-hmm. Which I just read while I was away and found actually, I must say, disappointing, because it's a lot about depression, really. But there's and it has very nice observations, and I love, she talks a lot about books she loves, but I thought it had no arc. And I think that does weaken a book's power. So in some way I saved the arc, because it's my life. Who knows if it's the real arc.
We have time for just one more question.
Oh. I thought we're in a library, and I found myself, as you were talking, thinking of Hamlet. Do you think Shakespeare or any other fiction, playwright, poet, got depression?
Yeah.
Did he get it?
I do. I think I just reviewed for the Wall Street Journal Robert a new biography of Robert Lowell by Kay Jamison, that bipolar illness, she has a sort of day fix, that bipolar illness goes along with poetic talent, which I'm not sure I see that clearly. But I think writers in general, I think, tend to be a somewhat depressed lot and have some understanding. Certainly think Shakespeare did, for sure. If he was one or many, he certainly had.
Thank you. Okay. I haven't read it yet, I've just seen it on the shelf, but she spoke here a few years ago.
How are you? What? We have a new member of the group. So. Oh, that's all right. You know. Okay. I think we can all wish you nothing. So close. Right? So close. I was thinking about using one of the rooms, but...
Yeah, and you're still reading? Oh, so much.
It's going to be another year.
I see Peggy.
I need someplace.
Oh, wonderful Peggy. Yeah, she keeps me talking tight.
If I'm going to meet somewhere, I doubt that.
Yeah.
I don't know. The public lets you be in there for a year. Right, but I think you can get it.
Yes, I think so. I think that's.
And we're what?
Well, no, ours you book.
But I mean, I thought we had something where we could do more than.
So you can do up to five visits at a time, and then you can take a week off and then go.
Yes.
So, you know.
It seems tiny.
Yeah. Well, we only have 6 rooms.
I know.
This is my first time. I like
to be able to do that. We could do that.
No. Well, we know we have to do it. It's not a matter of.
My ex was the vice president of the she's a fundraiser. Yeah, she's done for an entire year.
Think
of how big the campaign is. Get your number. The 35-40% in house.
Did you?
No. I mean,
yes.
I need the man's for, you know, money is there for everybody.
I'm so
look at the Met giving up on a $600 million.
No, it differs.
Everybody knows it. I mean, it's amazing how much we raise. You look at the country. A friend of Betty's Madison was hired by Cambridge. Years ago, when the British government told them, you got to go out and start raising money. And they had nothing.
Oh, really? Nothing
at all. They had no sense of that.
Yeah.
You know?
No, it's true.
No, the American effort is so much better done. That really is.
Thank you.
Existential, spiritual questions that we all deal with.